passion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of a nation. Savior, He can move a mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the
Jesus, shine a light in, let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Shine a Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy. Worship Your holy name. Bless You, time has come. Still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name, Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul.
The splendor.
Worship
You. Thank you. Study. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you once again for this time, Lord, as we have gathered here to look up to you intently, listen from your word, Father, and obey, Lord. We pray, Lord, that this Bible study might be meaningful to each one of us, Lord, even personally to me. Pray, Father, that you bless each one of us as we meditate upon this portion of the scriptures. And Lord, your word is powerful and active, and Lord, it changes lives, Father. And so, Lord, we pray that you speak to us through these amazing, powerful, eternal words of yours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we turn to 1 John chapter 3, and I will read verses 21 and 22. 1 John chapter 3. Verses 21 and 22. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from Him anything we ask, because we obey His commands and do what pleases Him. This is the word of our Lord. Shall we turn to this portion of scriptures? Today, the topic of my sermon would be confidence in prayer before God. Confidence in prayer before God. Christian community is a miracle-obsessed community. So many times we would want God to work in our lives miraculously rather than in natural ways. God has not exhausted Himself of ways to bless us. And God does work miracles in our lives. God answers prayers miraculously. God changes things which were impossible for us, things which were improbable for us. God changed those things in our lives in the past. God continues to work that way. In the Bible, we have so many miracles which are recorded, and outstanding miracles of God we read about. When we read about, we really understand that God is a miracle working God. But we also need to understand that God is the God of creation, and God also works through natural ways. He uses natural means. He uses natural ways to bless people. He uses people. He uses things, instruments. He uses so many circumstances to bless people and to bless us. And because we have been so much obsessed with the miracles of God, sometimes we think that if God has to work powerfully in our lives, then He has to do it miraculously only. We sometimes think that because God is doing a miracle in our life, in my life, God is in favor of me in everything that I do. Many times we think that only if I share about God's working in my life in a miraculous manner, then only I can show that God has showered His favor upon me. These are some of the things that we tend to assume when we give testimonies. And so many times, even if God has worked through natural ways, through normal medicines or through medical means, we would try to kind of show it off and tell people that God has done a miracle. By that I mean God has really suspended the natural order, and He has worked in outstanding ways in my life. But it is not so. So many times God has provided through natural means. God has worked through natural means. God has healed us through natural means. And we must understand that, you know, God does not have only miraculous ways of working. You know, of course, whatever He does is miraculous, but what I'm trying to say is God also works in natural ways. Many times we would think that because God loves prayers, God says that, you know, we must pray all the time. So if we pray so much, then God is going to listen to us and work powerfully in our lives. But we need to understand that it might not be so. In the epistle of John, first epistle of John, in chapter 3, in the verses that we just read now, John is in fact trying to tell people that we need to have confidence before God when we pray. We need to have It is not just praying for miracles. It is not just assuming that God is going to do marvelous things in our lives. It is not just about, you know, having a great faith. You know, I always tell that our so-called great faith does not supersede the will of God. And so we must understand that John is saying that we must have confidence before God. If our hearts, he's writing, dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, that is what he is saying. So there are certain things which come prior to prayers. The prayers that we offer, sometimes we think that because of our many words, our prayers would be heard. And we many times try to glorify prayers more than we try to glorify God. We tell things like prayers are powerful. It is because of prayers. You know, sometimes we also tend to say it is because of my prayers. Let me tell you, my dear friends, Jesus wants us very clearly, it is not because of many words, not because of so many hours spent in prayers that we get answers. Sometimes if God gives us answers because we tarry in prayers, it might not be in His perfect will. And so, what is prayer? Why so many times our prayers are not pleasing God? Why God does not like our prayers? What does God want prior to our prayers? And so here we are told that we need to have confidence before God. How does confidence happen? How does it occur? How do we get confidence in prayers? That is what we need to ponder upon. I would like to point out about four different things which can hinder our prayers. And if these hindrances we remove, we might have confidence before God. First of all, we must understand that in Matthew chapter 5, verse 23 to 24, Jesus very clearly points out to the hindrance of an unforgiving heart. So, a person is at the foot of the altar trying to offer something. Prayer is also an offering. And Jesus is saying in verse 23 onwards, therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in the front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gift. It is not just prayer. It is not just our desire to pray. It is not just pouring out our hearts before God. It is not just about many words that we offer at the altar of the Lord. But the word of God very clearly says that, you know, we need to have the right kind of inclination of our hearts. Here we are told that if there is an unforgiveness in our hearts, or actually it goes one step ahead, saying that if somebody has something against you, then we need to go and reconcile with that person, or we must go and, you know, do something that will bring about shalom, bring about peace between our brother and us. And so unforgiving spirit is what God dislikes. And I so many times tell that when we try to judge our Christian walk, we need to look inside our hearts and look within, and we need to think, you know, is the inclination of my heart pleasing to God? Like, if I do, am I, have I forgiven my brothers and sisters? So many times we resort to prayers even if we have already harbored unforgiveness in our hearts. We resort to prayers and we tend to think that somehow we are very religious, or we are loved by God, liked by God, because we are offering so many prayers before God. But God is saying that you leave your gift at the altar. And unforgiveness, unforgiving heart is an abomination to the Lord. And that is why we need to first of all be in a right kind of peace, right kind of relationship with each other. We need to be reconciled to each other so that our prayers would be answered. This is very, very important, my dear friends. This is very important, because so many times we keep on praying, we continue to pray thinking that, you know, God listens to our prayers, and because of the minutes or hours that are spent before the throne of God, we tend to think that God is really pleased with what I am doing. It's a religious offering, a religious duty that I am, you know, bringing before the Lord. Another thing is wrong intentions, like selfish or self-centered intentions that might be in our hearts that hinder our prayers. And so the word of God, James chapter 4 and verse 3, very clearly talks about the wrong kind of motives because of which our prayers might go unanswered. James chapter 4 and verse 3 says, when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. So the word of God says that so many times we ask with wrong intentions. Sometimes we think that Jesus has said that I am going to answer anything that you ask. But as I told, prior to that, we must be found in God. We must be in the right relationship with Christ and with one another. And we must have the right kind of intentions for, you know, the request that we are putting forth before God. And so the word of God very clearly says that your prayers are not answered because you do not have right kind of intentions, because you have selfish motives. You do not have a kingdom mindset. You do not have a mindset that is set on things of eternity. And that is why, you know, you are so self-centered and your prayers go unanswered. And this is very important. This is what happens, you know, in our religious offerings, so-called religious offerings that we do before the Lord. In Isaiah chapter 1, we are warned about this through prophet Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 1, and it would be, verse 15. But I would read verse 14 also. Your new moon festivals and your appointed feasts my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. It simply means that, you know, our intentions, our relationships are not right, are not in alignment with, you know, the word of God and the will of God. And so our prayers go unanswered. God is saying that even if you do many prayers, I am not going to answer you. Most of the times we think that because of the bulk of prayers, the number of the words that we offer at the feet of the Lord is going to answer us. But we need to understand that, you know, God looks at our hearts more than, you know, what we sometimes bring as a religious duty at the altar of the Lord. And so God is saying that I will not answer. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not answer. Your religious festivals, and whenever we conduct a religious festival, like, you know, Sunday is a religious festival, Sunday worship service is a religious festival, and, you know, it's a celebration of the resurrection of the Lord. And so many of our religious gatherings, corporate worship services and things like that, we tend to think that all these, because, you know, so many people participate because of the prayers that we offer, God is listening to us. But I want to tell you, my dear friends, that the Word of God says, your new moon festivals and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. God is saying that, you know, I'm weary of them. If we are not doing our religious functions in a way, in a manner that is pleasing to God, God becomes weary of us. God becomes weary of our festivals. And God will not listen. God will turn His eyes away from us. God will turn His ears away from our prayers. And so wrong intentions, you know, are hindrances to our prayers. Our prayers go unanswered because we do not have the right kind of motives. A stubborn heart is one such hindrance, you know, because it's also connected with wrong motives. Prayers of a stubborn person are detestable. I would not read out the whole verse before you, but in Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 9, we are told about this stubborn heart, a heart that does not honor the words of God, a heart that goes away from, wanders away from the word of God. The prayers of such a person is detestable before God. And so, not all prayers are acceptable before God. Not all prayers are pleasing to God. Not all people who pray, you know, are doing something that really pleases God all the time. It is not like that. There are some of the things that come prior to prayer. When we come before the Lord judges our hearts. The Lord judges our intentions, our motives, the inclinations of our hearts, our relationship, you know, how we have fared throughout the week, or how we have fared throughout the day, what have we paid back to people who have done evil to us. These are the things that God judges, and He does not look at our prayers as a detached offering from our life, you know, as an offering that is detached from our lives. You know, we think that prayers are something personal, and they should be so isolated that they need not have any connection with the lifestyle that we are leading. And that is another reason which hinders our prayers. Then we have another reason told to us in James chapter 1 and verses 6 and 7, which of course is a favorite of the faith preachers. Here the word of God says, but when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. he is double-minded, unstable in all he does. So when we come to God in prayer, we must believe and not doubt. We must believe and not doubt. This is what the word of God says. This is what James actually tries to tell us, that we must get rid of the doubt. Doubt is a hindrance to prayer. So what is doubt? Doubt is not just about my prayers would be answered. That is not the only thing. Sometimes we tend to bolster our faith in the sense that, you know, God is going to answer my prayers. That is a good kind of faith, and God does honor that kind of faith. But I would rather want to tell you that believing God is actually believing in the person of God, believing in the goodness of God, believing in the mercy of God, believing in the perfect will of God, believing in God even if the prayers are not answered the way I had sought, I had desired. You know, we bring prayers before the Lord, but we also give prescription to the Lord that this is how you need to work, this is how you ought to work, this is how you ought to answer my prayers. You know, other ways would not be acceptable by me, or I would not like it, or other ways would not be best suited for me. The thing is, when we come to God in prayer, it is good that we believe that God will answer my prayer. But over and above that, what is the faith that God wants? The faith that God wants is the faith in His goodness, in His person, that God is a good God. Even if, you know, He doesn't answer the way I want Him to answer, He is a good God, and whatever He does for me is good for me. That is the kind of reliance that God actually expects from us. And so many words do not mean that our prayers are heard. Thus far I have told, you know, I have given three reasons. First of all, unforgiving heart is a hindrance to our prayers. Secondly, wrong intentions are hindrance before the Lord. Thirdly, doubting His person, doubting His goodness is a hindrance to our prayers. And lastly, which is very practical but very important, is mistreating and being unfaithful to your spouse. Malachi chapter 2, let us turn to Malachi chapter 2 and verses 13 to 16. I would read out Malachi chapter 2 verses 13 to 16. Another thing you do, you flood the Lord's altar with tears. You weep and wail because He no longer pays attention to your offerings or accepts them with pleasure from your hands. You ask why? It is because the Lord is acting as a witness between you and the wife of your youth, because you have broken faith with her. Though she is your partner, the wife of your marriage covenant. The word of God says that, you know, I will no longer look in favor to your tears. I'm not going to pay attention to your offerings or accept them with pleasure from your hands. Why? Because you are unfaithful to your spouse. This is very important, my dear friends. As Christians, you know, our religiosity or our spirituality actually very well comes out within the bonds of the family, in the relationship between husband and wife, or any closed one. It comes out because God is saying that if we are unfaithful, to our spouse. Our spouse is, God does not answer our prayers. And the prayers of the husband might be hindered because we are not mentally and in actuality faithful to our wives. In the same way, the prayers of wives would be hindered if they are not faithful to the husband. Apostle Peter also admonishes husbands to be considerate to their wives. In 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7, the word of God says, husbands in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives and treat them with respect as the weaker partner and as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life, so that nothing will hinder your prayer. So mistreating your spouses, mistreating your wives, or mistreating your husbands, this is for the wives, can hinder our prayers before God. So if we keep on using wrong kinds of words, wrong ways of dealing with your wives, if we are not considerate, helping, encouraging, if we are not really working towards spiritual betterment, upliftment of our wives, you know, the word of God says that your prayers might be hindered. And so, my dear friends, in the end, I would want to say that it is wonderful to pray and bring many words before the Lord. But it is not just because of the many words that we bring before the Lord that our prayers are answered. And so what we need to understand is there are so many things that can hinder our prayers. And whenever we come at the altar of prayer, we need to judge ourselves, we need to examine ourselves, we need to see if there is any wickedness in us, if our relationships are not right, if our relationship with God is not right, if our relationship with our spouse is not right. We ought to examine ourselves, we ought to judge. In that sense, I'm using this word judge. We ought to judge ourselves in the light of the Word of God, whether we are in right kind of relationship with God and with our neighbors. I mean, other fellow human beings. We ought to judge ourselves. And may God bless us as we overcome these hindrances. And when we do, we will have confidence before God. God will answer our prayers. Maybe not in the way that we wanted, but definitely in a way that is better than our way, that is far more perfect and best for us. And whenever we come to the Lord in prayer, you know, this I believe these are some of the things which the list that I have given is not exhaustive, but these are some of the things that we ought to look at. We ought to examine our hearts on the basis of the Word of God and see if there is any wickedness in us, if there is any wrong motive, intention in us, if we are not in right kind of relationships, you know, with our spouse and with other people. May God bless us so that our prayers would be more meaningful and effective, and God will continue to use you mightily in this amazing ministry of prayer God will answer your prayers beyond measure and beyond our imagination, and God will bless us abundantly. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your gracious God. You are amazing God. You are all good God. Thank you, Father, for ministering to us in so many ways, Father. Listening to our prayers, which were weak, Lord. So many times, Father, offered in weakness. Lord, we really want to thank you for that. But we also want to strive for holiness, Lord. We also want to strive for removing all the obstacles to our prayers, Lord. And so, Lord, we pray, God, that you bless us. Help us to examine our hearts every time we bring the offering of our prayers at your feet, Lord. We pray, God, that you bless us, Father, so that, Lord, you may be pleased with our lives, Father, as with our prayers. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever, our hope, our strong
God, you do not think you are. step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.